todos mis errores acierto. Me regalé, con todos mis demonios me entiendo. No supe ver ni luces encendidas ni viento. Eso que ves cuando no estás vacío por dentro. Y entonces tú y un millón de estrellas y el universo entero ante mí, muy dentro de mí. No puedo perder nada en este viaje, mi salto sin red, miedos, mi equipaje, te encuentro y por fin sé que este es mi sitio. Y aunque no me crees, tú eres mi principio, tú mi principio. Y te encontré y allí mismo detuve mi tiempo y desperté y ya eras realidad y no sueño. Te contaré las únicas verdades que entiendo, tu amor, mi fe y todo lo que yo por ti. Y un millón de estrellas y el universo viene a decir, nos viene a decir, no puedes perder nada en este viaje, tu salto sin red, miedos ni equipaje, te tengo y por fin sé que este es mi sitio. Y aunque no me crees, solo es el principio y no puedo esconder más lo inevitable, mi salto sin red.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to a new episode of Talking Dogs with Ante. As I have promised already for some weeks, yes, we are going every Wednesday at the same time.
Mike off.
Happy that I'm managing to get really interesting guests week after week. What I will try to do also maybe in a soon future is try to get us maybe some sponsors to get the things look even better than they look now, and maybe to get some prices for the viewers, because there are so many people who are watching it regularly and asking questions, and I think we could make some nice gifts for all of you. Anyhow, I'm glad to see that the numbers are already going up of our viewers, because I'm sure that many of you will be very interested to hear my guest tonight. He's still quite a young person, but very, very famous, I must say. And then, of course, the most important thing about him that you need to know, that he was born on the same date as me. So that tells you everything about him. Anyhow, I'm very happy to have Mikael Nillson from Sweden as my guest tonight. Good evening, Mike. How are you?
Good evening. I'm very well, thank you. How are you?
Not too bad. Trying to survive these crazy corona times. I'm not going to ask you, Mike, for the start, like I ask everybody else, how is the situation in Sweden with the pandemic, because you have been quite lucky with it. You didn't have all this horrible lockdowns and everything, but unfortunately you have these restrictions on a number of people, and we just spoke, most of the big shows are cancelled in Sweden. How is the situation?
Yes, the Stockholm show is cancelled, and so are my dog shows, and today we got the information that the Malmö show in March is also cancelled, or rather delayed until May. So that is the situation. The indoor shows will not be held.
So how?
We are having some smaller specialty shows. we have the restriction under 50 people, so small specialties could be held.
How are you surviving without dog shows?
yes. I must say it is not as bad as I thought. I thought I was going to miss it more than I do. I don't show too much now. I only have one dog in the show trim and so on. But for the last 5 years, I really have been more concentrated in judging. So it makes a bit difference. You know, I don't hunt all the points and all the top winning titles and all that like I used to. Then it would be devastating.
Yeah, well, I think for most of us, it's quite incredible that we were thinking that like we will never be able to live without dog shows. And then at the end, it was like quite nice even to be at home and, you know, not to travel and everything. But somehow I think people now already start to miss it a little bit. And I hope the life will come back to normality soon, because a long winter all the time at home, I think we will all kill each other. So, but anyhow, let's hope for the better times soon. Anyhow, Mike, before I start with the serious questions, we have already over 130 people watching live, and a lot of people saying hello to you and to me. Many of them important dog people, breeders, poodle people. I see a lot of them. I will try to read more or less the most important comments to you during the show. And of course, everybody is encouraged to ask questions. If they have some questions for you, we always like to get questions from the people. But just to say that we have already people from Germany, from Sweden, from Italy, from South Africa, from Netherlands, a lot of people watching, so I'm happy for that, and I thank you all for being with us. Let's go, Mike, first to your childhood. When you were a young boy, how did you start your life with the purebred dogs? What was your connection with it?
Well, I always wanted dogs or horses, but luckily it never happened with the horses. It would be a bigger thing. But my dad was allergic to dogs, so he had a reason to say no to all our requests. But then we met a small toy poodle when we had a holiday, and the owners were allergic too. So it really was possible with a poodle. So, well, a week later, we had our little silver toy poodle. And that and for some reason, I think we already knew then that it was not going to be the last one, because we named him Ichi, which is number one in the Japanese.
Okay.
Yes.
That's the Japanese connection also already immediately in the start for you. I know that you know, I think most of the people have this kind of, like you say, quite strange start, you know, because you met a dog on the holidays and then it has actually changed your life forever. So sometimes these things happen, and I think that's quite nice. But okay, so you got your first poodle, but in 1993 you started to breed. Did you already know when you got your first dog that you will want to breed and to have dogs? And why kudos? What does it mean?
No, we had no idea we were going to start breeding, and not showing either. We brought him to a puppy show, and then we realized that he actually didn't have any testicles, not even one. So we couldn't do anything more with that. But, you know, it was a good experience, the first show. And I still remember it was Birgitta Svarsta judging. And she was so nice about it all. And we got our little rosette anyway. And but then we really realized we had to buy another one. So we bought a black one this time. And we improved with one testicle. So this black one only had one.
So you didn't want to make a big step from zero to two immediately, just step by step. Okay.
Yes. And unfortunately, this dog also got PRA in the end of his life. So that was also a bit of a tragedy. But the third one was a silver medium. Third one, yes. And he was he became a champion, but it was a male, so there were no puppies. And well, then later on we got some bitches and started to breed. Kudos, I wanted a short name, an easy name, something that sounded good in, well, several languages. And I brought out a dictionary and I found, and I always liked words with K. So I found Kudos. That was, and it sounds nice. It sounds, it's a positive word and it's used in the English language more like, well, if you have a speech, for example, you would say, you can say kudos to Ante for having such a beautiful dinner for us or something like that, or okay. So it's a very nice positive word, which I think is fine. Yeah. So that is that's how the kennel name came up.
Okay.
And it was it was very much a joint work together with my mother for all these years.
Yeah, that's nice. So it was a family affair.
Absolutely. Yes.
And you so after the one with one testicle and then the one with one with zero and one with one, and then you got the third one, but you said third one was the medium, so you started with the mediums to breed.
No, we didn't breed from him. The first litter was from a silver. I always liked silvers for some reason. And it was a dwarf, and we got the first champion in our first litter.
Oh, that's nice.
And then, but the silvers are very hard to breed from, and I've made several attempts later on too, and I've had reasonable success with them. But it has been the black ones have been more the variety I've been working with as a breeder.
Yeah, this is the interesting thing. I had 2 weeks ago as my guest Olga Selivestova from Russia, and we were talking about the Schnauzers. And then I was asking her, like, how does it come that, for example, in the breed like Schnauzers, for example, you can never get such a quality in giants in pepper and salts like you can have it in black. It's the same thing actually with the poodles. It's very difficult to get the quality, let's say, in apricot or in silver, the same as in black or in brown or in white. Why do you think is that?
Well, it's quite easy to answer why the silvers are hard to breed from, because you can breed them, you can mate them with a white one and perhaps get silvers from that, but normally not from the black ones. And once you mix blacks and silvers, you get this fading gene. So all the black ones will always be sort of off color. And as I live in a country with a lot of rules and a lot of tests, and I cannot dye them. And that's why I can also not really. I have mixed blacks and silvers, so I know how they can look like.
Yeah.
But it is hard. I am actually quite pro color mixing and also size mixing, because I think that's the only way of getting real quality in the minority colors. But it's difficult when we can't dye them.
Yeah.
Actually, yeah, you can't anywhere, but people do anyway.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I just want to say that, yes, on the paper, you can't do many things, but in reality, it's completely different. But anyhow, I have some questions about that for you also later on. Anyhow, before we start to talk more, there are already 30 comments, so let's just see what it is there. We have hello from many people. Bruno Paola, Viviana Nodali saying to you, hi from hi Mike, hi from Italy. Agneta Astrom, Anita Biklum, George Schogol, Francesco Cocchetti, Patrizia De Koning, Diane Stewart Ricci, Federico Sanguinetti, Paolo Malasoma saying Mikael is great in everything. Ruben Sanchez saying thanks for sharing this moment. Our dear friend Lila Westing saying, "Hi, dear friends." I will never remember, never forget this interview at Colare d'Oro with Lila. I think it's the funniest moment of my life. Jose Doval, "Hi, Ant and Mikael, watching you from the birth room. Good luck with the puppies, Jose." So it's a lot of dog people watching this, and I'm very happy about that and very grateful for all of them. Anyhow, we started a little bit your story about how you started and these things. But before I continue with the kudos story, I want to start with the, one of the most important dogs in your life, and that was certainly King, who has had an incredible career with you. Let me know, how did you get in touch with King? How did you become his groomer and handler?
I was involved already from beginning, already from before he was born. I'm very close friends to friend to his breeder Astrid, and it happened that I was going to Crufts. And then Lotta Sandell from Huffish Kennels, she wanted to me to look at a son of her stud dog in the UK, and perhaps she could bring this white Romeo back home. And I looked at him and I thought he was a beautiful dog, and I thought he was well before his time and really a modern dog, and so elegant in every way. And so it was. My suggestion was that he was coming to Sweden, which he went to her. And then quite soon after that, Astrid's bitch was in season, and it was like the perfect match. So my suggestion was that she should use him. And she did. And that was such a good thing, because the bitch was beautiful and she was very sound and honest and a beautiful mover and very well built. She just needed that little extra spice, which he could give, you know, a little bit extra length of leg, a little bit shorter back, a little bit more drama, which this stud dog could give. And so there were all these puppies born. It was... I'm not going to talk everything about this story, because it was a lot of tragedies around his owners, because it seemed like everyone died around this litter. And anyway, Astrid got all this.
Luckily, not everyone.
We don't luckily need all everyone. That. Yeah. And Astrid got all the puppies. And so then King was already, as a small puppy, a very promising one, of course. And the best one, the pick of the litter, was actually not King. It was another white dog, and he was beautiful. And he was also an all-breed best in show winner. He went as a stud fee puppy to Lotta. But King was the one with that really made a name of himself. And I showed him in, I remember he was about maybe 1.5 year old. And I showed him in August, and he was in a modern trim. He didn't even have a rubber band in his head. And
but they, sorry to interrupt you, they bought him as a pet quality. They didn't think in the beginning to have big shows or anything like that, no.
Yes, good, you stopped me, because yes, he was sold to the Glenas, Kari and Stein, and they had a similar start to me. You know, they had a standard poodle before with only one testicle.
That's how every success starts, with one testicle. So people who are watching, if you want to start in dogs, buy the dog with one testicle first, and the success will come.
That's true. Okay. Yeah. And but they were willing to at least try to show this King. And I thought it was a bit of a waste, because I thought the dog was so much better than taking such a risk, you know, with the new beginners. And I thought it would have been better way to make a deal with some breeders in America to send him there for a while for a show career and then come back in full coat, something like that. But it didn't happen. He came to, he was, because Astrid was always more careful with the family and the life of the dog. And she didn't really, I mean, she had had so much success with all her dogs. She was before that, prior to that, only breeding medium poodles. And she had had top dog all breeds several times and a group winner at the World Show and everything. So it wasn't the most important for her, you know. But the dog was got a beautiful life with Kari and Stein, and also a show career. So yeah. I showed him, I'm back to when I showed him.
Yes.
I showed him in August and he was in the modern trim. And I remember the feeling I had when I had him on the leash. And I said to the owners after, he got beaten by his litter sister. And she was in the show trim and everything. She had been to several shows and had more experience. And she was best of breed and he was best opposite. And I remember I told the owners that if we put him in the continental trim and do this right, he can actually win anything. And well, I guess I was quite right with that comment.
Yeah. But I mean, it's quite amazing sometimes that you get these, let's say, pet owners who never actually dreamed about having a top dog, and especially not a poodle, which takes a lot of effort to keep the coat and everything. But I mean, they proved, I mean, I know them personally, they proved to be amazing owners. And I mean, the career that this dog made, it's like out of this world. And in a way has put you also on a map as one of the most important persons in poodles. And that obviously started with 2002, which was the year, how they say, for you. How did it come that you took King to Crafts?
Yes, I'm going to continue with this show in August, because he was, well, we entered him for the Stockholm show, and that was in December, so 4 months later, or something like that. He was shown, and we could barely get a rubber band or two in his top knot. And he managed to win Best of Breed under Roger Stone. And he beat really top dogs like his own litter brother, and also Avatar Concord and many other dogs, obviously. And he won the group under Ellis Yule, and Reserve Best in Show under Michelle Billings from the States. And, you know, with barely no coat, that was a huge success.
Yeah,
and in the evening, Stein asked me, I got this paper here. What is this? Qualification to Crafts. what is that? I said, that's the biggest dog show in the world. Oh, King can go there. Yes. Shall we go? So we decided there and then that we should go. And we didn't even know who was judging or anything. And, you know, this was, we went to Crafts more than a year later. So we had, he was more an experienced show dog when we went there.
Okay. And then it happened, like one thing that one can only dream about but never thinks it's going to happen. What kind of feeling is to win Best in Show at Crafts?
Yes, it is the biggest thing you can win, you know. It's like winning Olympics or something like that, obviously. And it is, there are so many feelings that you can't really describe. And the fun thing is that it actually comes back to you, you know. When I'm watching the YouTube from the Best in Shows, I still get these goosebumps on my body, and I think it's wonderful. But really, it's hard to remember exactly. It's many years ago now, so there were many things around it, and a lot of people that say they were around me then, and I cannot remember. But that's how it is.
But the story says so.
But I was a bit, maybe a bit crazy at the time, but I had so much faith in the dog. I thought it was incredible in so many ways. I remember when I went to Crafts, I said to one of my best friends at the time, we had a dinner before, it was Margaret Villar, the racketeer breeder, and I told her, Yeah, she asked me what chance I had. I said, it's a pity that it's Terry Thorne judging the group, because I think I can win Best in Show under Pamela. And there are no stand-up poodles that can beat him in the UK right now. So it's a pity with a group judge. But it's I don't say that because I don't like Terry, and I thought he was a good judge in many ways, but he already had made him best opposite at the smaller show. So I thought it was not a chance.
Not very.
You never know.
But yeah, exactly. But I remember at that time, I mean, we did some shows together, more or less at that time of the year. I know you always had this this attitude, like, I'm going to win. Like, never having doubts or anything, like, you were always saying, no, I'm going to win. And I think that's the right way to think, and, you know, to go positive and to have faith in yourself and in a dog. And I think it brings a lot. It you can see it when somebody, like, believes in himself and believes in the dog. That's something very important, I think.
Yes, I work right now with training other handlers. That's basically what I do as a full-time job, and that's one of the big thing I have to teach people, how to believe in what they're doing, believe in the dog, because it is actually going right down the leash down to the dog. So if you have any doubts and any questions, your whole body turn into a question mark, and the dog is not giving it all. So from the very beginning, I think you must sort of give it all.
Yeah, that's very true. Anyhow, we have a lot of comments coming. Christina Chavrak saying hello to us, Dionysis from Greece. Bitte Arens Primavera, hello from Rome. Anna Sabo saying, I much enjoyed my time with you, Mike, a very clever and passionate dog person and master groomer. Looking forward to meeting up again in October. Divora Serra saying hello from Brazil. Sergei Lozin from Brazil. Then we have an interesting question from Siv Hilde Ovare. She's asking you, is it true that you brought water with you for King's Bath at Crafts?
Yes, it is.
Okay. And should I ask more about it? How much water did you bring to England?
Quite a lot. You know, it was for the final rinse, and King's coat was actually quite soft and difficult to get volume in. So, and I always thought when I was in England that my own hair was kind of falling down. It's so difficult to do anything. So you know, it's I think it made a big difference to have that in the final rinse. And you know what? We brought double, because I said we're using half, because if we win the group, we have to have more.
I just wanted to ask you that. I was hoping that the group and the Best in Show were on the same day, so you had enough water with you, but you were bringing double. Okay. I've never heard anything similar to that, but I just hope Javier is not listening to this, because that could be something that he could start doing, and then I'm really in a problem.
But you know, Ante, it's the same thing with believing in it. You know, if you still believe in, if you believe that it's going to make a difference, even if it's a so small micro millimeter thing on each hair, and like, if I believe it, then I'm more convinced that I've done absolutely everything I can.
Exactly. Even bringing 60 or 80 liters of water from Sweden, I say that's like, okay, absolutely. That's when you really believe in yourself, and not only to believe in yourself, this is when you really want to do the thing perfect. And yeah, I really appreciate that with people, you know, because, you know, this is the thing that you think, okay, I want it all perfect. Not, I'm not going to risk with anything. And that's just what makes great professionals. Okay, I want to ask you, Mike, because that's always something quite controversial in the dog world. People say when a dog wins something huge, then, you know, is it better to leave him at home and never show him again, or it's better to continue showing him? You continue showing King after Crafts. How did that go?
Yes. We were obviously discussing what we should do, but we were very convinced that we should continue. And so more or less to be try to make him top dog all breeds in Norway, which we did in 2002. And we wanted him to bring him to the world show and European show so people could see him, because obviously most people hadn't seen him. And I thought he was such an eye-catching dog and very special. And I wanted everyone to actually see how they can look like.
Yeah. I want to ask you, after that, obviously he has won best in show at the World Dog Show in Amsterdam the same year. And then he was third best in show in at the European show in Paris. When you have a dog of that quality who has won something big like that, is it like you go and you know you are going to win, or there has still been some judges who were coming and saying, no, it doesn't matter what he has won, I just don't like him? How difficult is to deal with that? I mean, when you have one dog who has won so much.
Yes, it's not so easy to answer, because I always think when a dog is on the top of the career, you are the one that people want to beat, and it's a big pressure on me as a handler and a groomer, I kind of like more the idea of building the dog up than defending your position in some way. I with other dogs I've done sort of different things, but with King he was sort of in the beginning. I think if I had him now, I would probably do a little bit different with his career. I think we started him at least a year or two too early. And if you're only going to show a dog for 1 or 2 years, like I've usually done after that, it's better to bring them out when they're mature, yeah, and when they're, yeah, ready for it. And well, I don't know if you can say we did wrong, but anyway, you know, I really wanted to show him more, because we didn't feel we were finished at all with him.
Well, definitely you were not finished. I have mentioned Amsterdam World Dog Show and the European Dog Show in Paris, but there has been much more. Can you just say some of the biggest thing that he has done after Kraft?
Yes. He won Best in Show at most shows we showed him after that. We brought him to Collar d'Oro, which you already mentioned, which was in the end of the year, and he was Best in Show there. And Collar d'Oro was a fantastic show. It was on television, and it was, I don't know how many thousand people on there, and it was a big show with a lot of lightly dressed women and everything Italy. It was in Milan. It was wonderful. I know you were there as well, but perhaps not all the viewers know.
That's really one of these shows that I often think about it, and I think like it's such a pity that or Collare d'Oro or anything similar to that doesn't exist anymore, because not only because it was fun for us who were going there to show the dogs and everything, but it was such a huge promotion for the purebred dogs. I mean, it was just like if you think now about it, and that has been, let's say, 10 years ago or more, it has been like out of this world how much of promotion it was bringing to purebred dogs.
Yes,
but anyhow, continue.
Yes, and when we were at Crufts, we got to see the calendar with judges for the UK shows, and we decided there and then that if he get the CC, we bring him 2 weekends in a row. We stay and show him at the Welsh Kennel Club and a Scottish Kennel Club, and he won in Wales. He was Best in Show, and it was a fabulous win, because it was no other than Hans Lettinen judging the all groups and Best in Show, and that is one of the wins I really well, remember the most. And then he won the group at the Scottish Canon Club. So he was made up in three shows.
Yes.
And so that was obviously great. You know, I think that the British dog scene is really, it's where it's this sport started, and I always value and treasure the wins there most. And I think now when I'm more a judge, I really look to England to learn more and see huge classes, and
this
obviously
yeah.
Crofts is the show to go to. And
yeah.
I'm sorry, not all new breeders or judges really understand. I don't think they understand the greatness about it. But you know, it's not obviously not so much about grooming. It's not so much about showing, but it's about dogs.
Yeah.
And it's about what it should be. And that's to really put the dogs in order of merit. And that's what they do.
Yeah, yeah. But, certainly, yeah, in the UK, you can still find in many breeds amazing quality of dogs. And of course, when you think about shows at Crafts, also strange things happen sometimes in the breeds and so on. But in general, that's really the place to go and to see the best of dogs in so many breeds. I agree with you.
Yes.
But then not only a great success in the UK, you have gone with the King also to the USA.
Yes. And that, well, I will continue with 2002 first, because we ended with in great style, winning Best in Show at Oslo International under Carlos Renau. And then he won Best in Show at Stockholm International. So that was fantastic. And then 2 years later, we brought him out to only one show, and that was Stockholm International, and he won it one more time. So he actually had three group wins at Stockholm, two best in shows and one reserve, which I think is a huge result for any dog. And then we brought him to the States, as you mentioned. And still, when I go to PCA is the Poodle Club of America national specialty. Still today, people stop me and say how fantastic experience it was to see King there, because he got standing ovation going into the open dog class, which he won. And he was best of winners at that show. And then we took him to three all breed shows right after that, 3 days in a row, which he won best in show at every all three of them. So
yeah.
That was.
We know that's not very easy in the USA with the handler from Europe. That's for sure.
No, because also they withdraw all the dogs when they see a special dog like that is coming. They don't want to go through all the work with all the hours of preparing a standard poodle. So he had to get his majors from beating other breeds. And there were 5-point majors in other breeds during those days. So he was made up in also three shows in the States.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. In a way, finish the story of King, because there is still a lot to talk about. When did you decide that you are going to stop showing him?
I can't remember. I can't remember.
Well, I read that you showed him once in the veteran class.
We did, obviously.
That has been his last show, I suppose.
Yes.
But these were more or less, I think, the major wins that he did.
It was best veteran in show and reserve in second in the group or something like that.
Anyhow, we have a lot of comments coming in. Agneta Astrom saying training very much under Mike. He has taught me a lot. Siv Hilda Oraver saying I'm so happy I got to bed there and watch you and King going best in show at Crafts. That was amazing. And then, of course, wonderful. We have a message from Kings owners. Kari Glenna is writing, "Hi, Mikael and Ante. I'm following you the greatest time of our life. We will never forget this. And our King, it opened up for us a world we didn't know at all about. So much fun and so many wonderful people we met." They have been absolutely amazing people. And I mean, I think one is always lucky to get a client in a way to share this journey to somebody like them. Divora Sera saying they did great at World Dog Show in 2002. Beautiful job. I was there. Lucy Hagman saying I was and see King at Collare d'Oro because I was working for Mario Massa. Vania, I'm not going to pronounce the surname because it's very difficult. Greetings from Greece. Oh, this conversation already is so very interesting and fun. Thank you both. Let's see, Peter Acker, the pleasure to listen. Anita Biklum saying King also became Dog of the Year in Norway that year. Lord King. Francesco Cocchetti saying nice to feel the passion and nice to see the approach a breeder judge has. This is why I always think that before to be a judge, it is a must to be a breeder. Well, I think many will agree about that. Let's continue, Mike. Let me see, when did I come? Because I started the conversation and then I just got into the questions and I lost one. I wanted to ask you, and I asked you already a little bit about this when you continue showing King, and that now doesn't have to do only with King, but in general with the dogs. When you have a dog of that quality which goes around and wins weekend after weekend, and let's say wins in his own breed, do you feel more, let's say, a kind of jealousy between the people in the breed, or you get the encouragement from the people in the breed, even if they know that there is now this dog which is almost impossible to beat in the breed?
I would say that most people have been very nice about it, and certainly with King, and after he won Crufts, you know, there were, I would say, almost entirely positive from the competitors. I would think that perhaps some dogs didn't show, some people perhaps didn't enter because they already knew that they couldn't beat him. That can, of course, happen. But I always think that, you know, showing dogs, especially on a high level, has a lot to do with also networking. You know, it's something I must, as a handler, be some kind of almost like a salesperson and promote what I'm selling. And I have to be nice to people. And well, I think you have to be nice, you know, I have to be nice. And you never know when you need someone's help with something. And it's good to be a little bit approachable. And well, if you only step on people, that's not going to be a nice situation for the future.
Yeah, that's for sure. Anyhow, we followed now this story of King, and one could say that it's amazing what you have done with him. But I mean, you didn't win, let's say, much less with your own bred dogs. And I mean, you have won three groups at three different World Dog Shows with three different dogs, a number of top dog old breeds. And I mean, your kennel has been extremely successful. What I want to ask you first about that, is it a different feeling to show a dog bred by you? Is it more stress or less stress?
No, I wouldn't say it is much of a difference. My approach to showing in the first place was, or to breeding, I never really had the, it's wrong to say I never had a passion, because I had, but I never had a, it was not never my dream to become a breeder. I wanted to show dogs. I wanted to have good show dogs. And I tried to buy some dogs, and it was impossible. And then I just found out that, well, I better do them myself. Yeah. And so that's why I started to become a breeder. And when I showed, when I showed King, it was Astrid's breeding, but I was so involved in everything. And having her as a breeder and Glenn as the owner and me as the handler, and other people were helping with the daily maintenance of the coat too. It takes a village. It's a huge teamwork, and I think that was big fun, part of the fun to do it like that. So I don't think it. I never thought it added any extra that I was also the breeder to them. Then it was because my mother was more also sort of involved in it. That made a
more
nice
pressure
thing.
On you.
Okay. Yes, but she was never really that type of a fighter. But and every dog I have been showing that I haven't been bred that I haven't bred myself, it has been bred by my friends, and that's basically the way I've done it, you know. And well, if I've bought a dog, I have usually become a friend with the person that bred it. So then it makes a nice thing to do it, you know.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's interesting, because I feel sometimes, because at some point of my life I also started to breed dogs, and I thought it is not a different feeling to show them, but in a way also it is a little bit, you know, like when you think. Okay, this is, I have done this job, you know, I have been a part of this life of this dog from the beginning. But then, of course, you had completely different story with King, which actually, okay, it was not your name as a breeder, but you have been so much involved from the beginning that it felt almost the same, like you were a breeder. Tell me, Mika, you have now mostly black miniatures. What I want to ask you, because you had so much experience with different sizes of poodles and different colors, how much they are different, let's say, temperament wise, in the compared to the sizes and colors? Is there a change, or a poodle is a poodle?
Oh, there are some changes, but it's a quite big question, because I think it could be a little bit different between the sizes also. There are minor things. We sometimes say that the brown ones are a little crazier, and the apricots could be stubborn and things like that. But basically, it should be the same. And as a breeder, I've always tried to breed when I not only talking about the temperaments, but also the look. You know, I think it should be a poodle type, one type for varieties, and they should look the same. If you only saw the dog without any thing around that you can compare size with, you shouldn't be able to really tell what size it is, and that's hard. But I've always tried to do that. I always thought all the sizes and all the colors, you should sort of look for the same things.
Yeah, but is it just my feeling, or from my experience, that for example, standard poodles when they are young, they are a little bit more wild than other sizes. I think the standards, they really are quite wild when they are young dogs.
They are. Yes, they are.
Yeah, they are. Yeah, they're not easy. Anyhow, we were talking a little bit about breeding the dogs. What I want to ask you, in a way, are poodles, in your opinion, easy to breed, or they are not easy to breed, and why so? And also, I want to ask you about poodles health-wise. How healthy is the breed at the moment?
And when you ask easy to breed, do you think like breeding a Best in Show winner? Is it?
No. That's not easy, never, in any breed. But in a way, is it easy to find good dogs to mate? Are the people in the breed okay to mate? Is it easy to find a good quality dog, you know, to import in your lines?
Yes, and
I suppose they don't mate without problems. I suppose they deliver puppies without problem. I would not think that poodles are difficult in that way.
It's quite easy in that sense, and I would say I bred all sizes, and I would say standard poodles is quite easy to breed, and it's quite easy to breed a winner too. I I had a litter with, I don't remember if it was six champions and several group winners and best in show winners, and I don't even consider that litter especially good, you know. It was just one combination I happened to do, and I think the breed, standard poodles, there are many of them around the world, and if you put a little bit of effort to find your stud dogs and willing to spend some money for perhaps importing semen and things like that, it is possible. And selecting puppies, if you have 10 in a litter, it's quite easy to select and get what you want. Breeding the toys and the dwarfs, like I've done, it's not the same thing, because it's the litters are small, and I always struggled with that. You know, I never really was able to select between four bitch puppies. That's luxury I've never had, and sometimes in some generations I could take four litters from a bitch, and I only had one bitch puppy to carry on with. So yeah. I think in that sense it has been difficult for me. I have had quite easy to import dogs I wanted, but I'm also in a position where I have friends all over the world, and I've proven that I actually can present them in a way and make a career out of a nice dog. But I also think it comes down to, I will tell you a story from when we were in Scotland, when the day King was made up a champion. I found this really, really nice black toy poodle male. I thought he was beautiful and so nice. And of course, he was placed last in his class. It was not a big success for him then. And I went up to this owner, and I've never met her before. And I said, I really like this dog. And I started to talk to her, and it happened. I asked if I could perhaps have him for a year or two. And she immediately said, no, it's her pet dog and everything. But she was a breeder, you know. And then she was thinking about it, and she watched me show King. And she told me after, she decided when she saw me showing King and actually being quite effective, showing affection to the dog. And I kissed King on his muzzle when we were stopping. And she said, I can actually send my dog to him because it's nice to the dog. Yeah, and I think it proves you have to be very nice with dogs. I'm sure many people are, but for that reason, she let me have him for a year or two. And well, I had one litter only after him, but an important stud dog, Kudos Fantomen, came from that, and he's behind many dogs on the continent, especially in the brown variety.
Tell me, Mika, when we talk about breeding, you said yourself you have find like these dogs that you have liked, and then you would bring them and use them in your breeding program. Did you use more, let's say, as a breeder inbreeding and line breeding, or you have done quite often out crosses which has worked well for you? What do you think is the best combination?
I will tell you just briefly about my breeding program. I've had three foundation bitches, and they, unfortunately, I would say now, they were not unrelated. They were related. It would have been a little bit better if they were unrelated. I always try to breed sort of the type I like. You know, I can't breed to a dog I don't like. And it just happened that I started to line breed because those were the dogs I liked. And it was from the top score medium poodles and the Solnes toy poodles. That was sort of the type
you like.
Type I liked, yes. And then I tried to separate the lines a little bit, but I actually had very good success combining these three lines too. But the reason why I say that is because the bitch line where Tyson comes from, that's Kudos, the knockout dog that won the group at the World Show in Dortmund. It was actually quite bad fertility in that line. And I didn't notice that until almost too late. And I had to rescue the line by outcrossing a lot. And I would think that I shouldn't have line bred so tightly. It has been a success for me to line breed, but still I run into problems there and then. And it was fertility problems, and it was very difficult to breed when the bitches, it's hard to get them in whelp. There are very small litters, nothing to work with. And especially when I got my third foundation bitch, the Russian line, those were a little bit stronger dogs. Those were a little bit sort of overall, I wouldn't say healthier, because I've always worked with healthy dogs, but they kind of had more vitality or strength to them in a nice way. And it completely changed. Oh, is this the way to be a breeder, when you can actually select from what you have? And so I think you need to be a bit careful what they're producing.
Yeah, because I know that many top breeders, in a way, when I ask them this question, most of them, they say they like to do mostly line breeding because they know what they put in their lines and so on and so on. But in a way, I think that also the strategy that you use with bringing maybe dogs which are not related to yours, but are top quality dogs, obviously brings good results if you have a good line. So I think, yes, probably
the best
same
is
like
to have a strong bitch line which could sort of take any spice and still be sort of the same dish, you know. I would say the Russian line I got was very much like that. You know, you could bring different things in and you still had the same look. And it's still today that line is producing very much the same look, which is a good way.
Yeah, I remember. I mean, we spoke many times with Stefano in Franco, and we were talking about many times about the Maltese, because they have this like possibility to bring this great Maltese year after year. And he said, my bitch line is so strong that actually from time to time I just need to bring some new blood, but it doesn't need to be something spectacular, because my bitch line is so strong that it's for sure going to give the quality. So obviously, yes, the bitches are quite important. Tell me, when you have the possibility, because you said you don't have often the possibility, but when you have the possibility to choose the puppy for yourself or the puppy to sell as a show prospect, what do you look in a puppy?
Well, I look for the same thing as in an adult. Obviously, the type is so important, and the poodle has to have the proportions, and the shape is very important. And I think the body type I think it's very much misunderstood how a poodle should be under the coat. And for me, a poodle should resemble a ballet dancer. It should be no body fat at all. It should be lean, it should be muscles, and it should be strength with elegance. And that's how I vision the poodle. And too often it is more the bodybuilder type, or too strong dogs, or even couch potatoes, you know, not the right condition, or even not the right body type from to begin with. So I think that is very important to bring into it. You know, the poodle needs to have a short back, and it needs to be up one leg, and has great, it must have head carriage, tail and head up is a must, and lightness of feet. So a lot of times I think that is also misunderstood. I see a lot of poodles run like idiots around the ring, and they don't have the lightness. They must be very light, and bring them half the speed and you will see it. and they need to carry themselves with effortless and lightness.
Yeah, yeah, this is a big problem in many breeds, and I mean, for somebody like me who got a lot of weight, sometimes it's difficult to follow. But I don't know why these young people, they really think that more they run, better it is. And in many cases, as you said, it's not really like this. Like I see it in many breeds that the dogs are just being overspeeded all the time in the ring, and it's like it's even impossible to look at them because they run so fast that you don't manage even to catch the essence. But you mentioned Mika a lot, the type. If I would ask you now, when somebody see a dog bred by you, a kudos poodle, is there something that makes, let's say, kudos poodles different than other ones? Is there something that you think you got so strong in your line that makes a change for the breed?
Yes, I think there are, and many people have said it also, noticed this, that my dogs, they always carry themselves, no matter how they're constructed, no matter what kind of fault, they carry it with style. And that's very important to me. And I don't like long dogs, so they should be sort of short-backed. The poodle should be slightly longer than high from the breed standard, but almost a square. And I don't go far from that. And I want the poodle movement. You know, I don't want these dogs with wide fronts going down deep, digging into the ground. That's nothing at all. You know, I want them up and keeping the silhouette while moving.
Yeah.
And another thing that has been very, what I have been putting a lot of emphasis on for my own line is I have to have a beautiful expression. I hate dogs in my house with not good enough faces. And I have been very careful with that. I don't want to breed to a dog with less than a beautiful face. And well, I have other things that you wouldn't like, but those things are normally always on my dogs.
Yeah, yeah. And tell me. Of course, this presence and attitude and courage in the ring, of course, is partly a big part, also a part of the construction of the dog. But in poodles, when we talk about temperament, how important you think is a temperament in poodles for this courage? What you said, sometimes you can have a dog even not so perfectly constructed, but they carry themselves. Is that a part of the temperament?
Yes, it is. It's part of the temperament, part of the build. And I look for that immediately. Coming back to the original question about the selecting puppy, I look for it immediately. They have to, once they start moving, I look for the ones carrying themselves, you know, because it's so important. And I think the temperament is for the poodle, it's a unique temperament. And you have to have that
sparkle.
Yes, they should be, actually, from the breed standard, says a poodle should be easy to train, and they should be intelligent, and they should be active, and they must have some humor and some sense of style. Also, the dog need to have the kind of feeling that they're of a diva. A really great poodle should just enter the party and everyone looks at you, you know, with a beautiful sparkling dress, and the party stops and everyone looks at you.
Yeah. This is one of these things that when you look at the dogs, you know, the temperament is obviously something extremely important. And I mean, I had a standard poodle at home, and what bothers me sometimes is, you know, you show one breed under the judge, and if the judge doesn't have the feeling with the breed or doesn't know enough, I know that many times with the standard poodles, you know, people will say, oh, this was a nice dog, but he was not trained and so on. Somehow I feel that when you see let's say a standard poodle, which is wild as a young age, I see it as a plus, because I think this one is wild and he's going to become a good show dog later on. He's not going to be boring. You know, I think poodle is one of these things, one of these breeds where you just hate to have a boring dog. That's the most.
Think, unfortunately, talking about standard poodles, many times that is rewarded, that are standing like a statue, which I completely disagree with that. I don't like to only judge a dog standing and look down just into the wall. They need to have the sparkle. I rather take them jump around a little bit extra. And everyone that saw King, remember him, know how wild they can be. And and I just thought that was wonderful. Yeah. But also kind of when I'm judging poodles, you know, especially standard poodles, I never have problems with them because I know how to approach them. And if you're not really able to measure every bone in the body on the junior dog, well, maybe you can still judge him, you know.
Yeah.
And but we don't have to force it, force them to do it.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, we have a question from Brinia Tomer. She's saying, warm greetings from Colombia. Thanks for this interview with this top handler breeder. I would like to know if Mikael thinks that poodles are more a male breed or a female breed. Meaning, do you find the males or the females to be more poodles? I hope you understand what I mean.
Yes, and it's a very good question, and which I really have thought a lot about. And I think that that's what separates me as a judge from many other ones. I think 100% a female. When I dream about the perfect poodle, it is always a female that adds to the extra elegance to it. And a lot of times you see the males winning a lot because they are sort of having a little bit extra testosterone, and they just sort of enter.
And they're a bit bigger and so on.
Bigger, stronger, more impressive, and more powerful, and that. And that is not exactly what the breed, this breed is about. It's more about the elegance. And when I look at the results from judging, I often put up bitches. I mean, mm-hmm. I would also put up a nice male if I have, but I adore bitches.
Yeah. Tell me, Mika, another thing. You have become not famous in poodles only because of your ability to show them, but you also groom them by yourself, and you have always been extremely successful with that. How for the beginning, how difficult is to keep the poodles in the show condition?
If the dog has a nice coat, it's not so difficult at all. I usually, in average, would say maintenance bath every weekly. And that shouldn't take that long time, you know. Now I have the dwarf variety, you know. I spend maybe 1.5 hour weekly on my dog, which is not that much. But of course, then I know how to do it. And if you start and you don't know, then you will use a lot more time. And you would avoid the matting and the tangling at all costs. So that's when you would put the dog in the bath. Go through the whole process of bathing and drying it.
And I wanted to ask you, because it's one of these breeds in which grooming is obviously extremely important. I understand when you are a breeder, that's not the most important thing, but when you are judging, do you find yourself sometimes in the difficulty that there is maybe a dog which is a better poodle, better built, but in a horrible grooming or in horrible coat condition, with a dog which is a little bit less good under the coat, but it's amazingly groomed? How difficult is that in a breed like a poodle?
Yes, there are always borders. And you say horrible, I wouldn't want to put up anything that looks horrible. But I think it's very important that it is not becoming more of a grooming and handling competition than it is today. I think it's too important nowadays, and I think it's we should go back a little bit to basic. I think I probably am able to take a little bit of more balanced decisions when it comes to exactly what you ask about. I know what you can create with the scissors because I've changed so many dogs during the year, years, and I've seen dogs in perfect grooming, and I've seen really beautiful dogs in not so good. I will tell you another story, which I think is very significant how things are nowadays, which I think is a bit sad. I was at PCA a few years back, I think 2-3 years ago, and it happens to the best in show happened to go to a miniature poodle, a beautiful bitch, and she was shown by Chris Manopoulos, who is one of the absolute top handlers and groomers, and that dog was bred in Sweden, about 2 hours from where I live. And the Swedish breeder were there, and I went up to her and hugged her and said, congratulations, fantastic win and everything. And she was just in tears, and she said, oh, and Michael, you were the first one and only, and almost the only judge to put that bitch up. And this breeder and owner, it's not at all like she's doing a horrible job. She's doing a basic job, beautiful job, perhaps not exactly as stylish as I could do it or someone else, but perfectly beautiful job. And she has been in the breed for longer than I have. And when she was shown in Sweden before PCA, the judges didn't find her. She was beaten by so many different dogs. She won something, but not at all to the extent of her quality. And I just think it's sad. I think it's very sad that people don't find. And I'm involved in judging education here in Sweden. And I try to find a way to teach how to approach all this, because I don't think it's handled at all now. I mean, I would say the win at PCA is more accurate to that dog's bitch quality than her very mediocre results here in Sweden.
Yeah. Talking about poodles, and I mean, we said obviously it's not the most important thing, but it is extremely important thing, the grooming. And then we come to this point of all these stories about hairsprays, and you cannot use this and you cannot use that, and everybody cannot use, but everybody use. What is your opinion about hairspray and poodles?
If I were to decide, I would absolutely let people use hairspray and all cosmetics. I don't think that's harmful at all. I just think it makes them more beautiful. So it's a quite easy answer. However, you know, here in Sweden, I've been forced to leave hair samples 9 times of my dogs. 9 times. So I really am living.
Somebody thinks that you are a bad guy, I think.
I prove that I'm a good guy.
Okay. Yeah. But this is what I think all the time. I'm on the same road as you are about the use of cosmetics, because we are not talking about over grooming. We are talking about normal grooming and preparing dogs for a beauty show. And I think you know, they should be beautiful the same like we people want to be beautiful. I mean, if you expect from a poodle to have this big top knot on the head and everything, is it even possible to make it decent without some kind of product inside?
Well, I will say we are teasing the hair. That's how we do it, and we cut it down a bit. Not use that huge top knots. However, I think when you do it properly and the dog has a good coat, I think it is actually nicer without hairspray. I must admit that. Standing, it's another story. It just kind of falls. But I think a little bit of hairspray should be allowed, and we should be, and it would look much nicer. That's just
That's for sure.
But you know, wherever they are using hairspray, it becomes too much and goes overboard. And well, I know how it is because I'm the same way. You know, you just add a little bit more, and then you never step back and look. Oh, this is actually too much.
Yeah, that this is the problem, that in many times it goes to this what we call it over grooming. So I think generally it should not be forbidden. It should just be mentioned that there should be a balance. You know, that it's not too much, but definitely I in my eyes there is no doubt that the poodle is much more nice with a little bit of hairspray than without it. That's for sure. But with all these new rules and regulations about grooming and no hairspray and no scissoring at the show and no this and no that and no chain leash, and do you think that let's say in 10 years poodles are going to look still the same, or somebody will have to do something about these clips on them to change them a little bit to look more normal without the products that they say are not anymore possible to use, like Germany, Austria, Switzerland, places where you just can't use anything?
Well, we'll see what the future brings, because I'm worried in many areas, and I know you usually bring up that in your interviews, and I'm worried not only for this, but for many other things. And I just hope we are still doing this in 10 years, and that we are actually, you know, on the same path, because I think what we're doing is a good thing. You know, we are actually going to dog shows, judging dogs. It's basically a way to evaluate breeding stock. And I think that is helpful. And I think it's a good thing. And I just hope that the kennel clubs will be able to sell that idea around, because that's what we have been doing for so long time. I don't think we have been doing anything wrong.
Yeah, I agree with you.
And I think from all dogs I see, the most well-kept and the dogs in excellent conditions are the dogs at dog shows. It's not the dogs on the streets. It's not my neighbor's dogs. It's the dogs I see at the dog shows.
Yeah, I agree with you. Okay, my last question about grooming and poodles is going to be about this, how do you call them, stitches or extra hairs in the top knots. I don't know how often that happens or it doesn't happen. What is your opinion on that?
It happens more often than I think, Ante.
I'm sure it does, yes. But
and I actually don't think I don't think it's a big problem, and I would not penalize any dog for it. I don't think that's my job at all in the ring. In some countries, like in the States, more or less all of them have it, and well, if they carry them why not?
I want to ask you, what is actually the reason for that? Like, is it that people are not able to grow the coat, or it just why I mean, is it possible to get them looking good even without that, or that's just a shortcut to success, or what it is about?
Well, there are people do it for many different reasons, I would say, and some people they don't really take care of the coat and all that, but if you're using switches, it's basically to get more hair in front and right on top of the head, which actually adds, they don't usually have so much hair exactly there, and they could look a little bit nicer that way. However, it's the same thing. If you use too much, it becomes heavy, and anything that looks heavy doesn't add anything to the look of a beautiful poodle.
Well, probably the same like what we were talking about, the use of products. If you do it, let's say, in a normal way and with kind of balance, why not? Anyhow, there are a few comments that I want to read to you before we continue with the questions. Alex Rojas saying, very interesting talk, regards from Mexico. Then we have Vera Andra saying, Ante, remember, poodle people does not use hairspray. It stay like this naturally. Yes, I suppose that was Jason Hoke saying, great breeder, great discussion. Christina Terbonen saying, thank you, Ante and Mikael, for very interesting talk this evening. It is very interesting watching this on Wednesdays. Thank you. Have a really nice evening. Kari Glenna saying, thanks to, it's passing too far. Thanks to both of you for this interesting and memory session. Hope to see you soon. Very interesting talk, even for me as a Ridgeback breeder, thanks to the both of you, saying Susan Falk. And now I'm going to ask you a question, and then because that was more or less my question also, and it is about the new colors in the breed, these black and tans and harlequins and so on. And there was a question from, let me find it, just a second. Carmen Sifonte saying, does Mikael think there will be a space in the breed for the party colors, or they should be kept separate? Very curious.
I'm a quite old-fashioned breeder in many ways, and I'm quite old-fashioned in this way too. I would not want to breed any party colors or harlequin, as they call them, any black and tans. That's not what I would like to have. I think that it has become so many of them everywhere. And I think the sensible way of doing it is to actually have them as a separate breed. And the reason for that is that I don't think it's correct like we have it in Sweden. They are combined in the gene pool. And the Kennel Club, they want it this way because they say that they add to the breed, to the gene pool. And in my opinion, it's completely the opposite. I would stay away from any dog with any of this in the background. So the best way, I think, is to have them as a separate breed and not mix them.
Yeah, because somebody wrote something. I didn't go into details. Was it a French club or whatever who said that all these dogs, let's say poodles in different colors, are not allowed anymore to be called poodles?
Yes.
I don't know if that's official statement or what it is. So obviously
it is an official statement from the French Poodle Club, and I think that statement came about 10 years ago. It's a long time ago.
Yeah. Okay. So obviously they will probably continue to exist, but they will be called something else. Anyhow, Lila Vesteng is saying to us, thank you for an interesting interview. Hopefully I will see you soon. Dennis Gustafsson, thank you both of you. George Schogel saying, you guys look so similar today. Great interview. A real pleasure to listen. I told you, George, it's because we were born on the same date, not the same year, but the same date. So obviously we look a little bit similar. Francesco Cocchetti is saying they are not poodles. Party colors is another breed. So there are always different opinions about the things. I want to ask you, before we start with these short questions, a few more things. If somebody would offer to you and say, Mike, here is the poodle standard, change what you think needs to be changed, what would you change?
Oh, that is an interesting question. The first thing I would do is to have an international meeting and with the idea of having a worldwide standard, because right now we have at least three standards, three major ones, the American standard and the English and then FCI standard. And
are they very different, these three standards?
They are not very different because, well, that at least the dogs are not that different. We have been able to win with a top dog in, like, King. He won in FCI countries in the States and in England. And we have seen many dogs like that coming to the other countries and winning. But they describe the proportions differently. It's a squarely built breed in the States, and it's slightly longer here, and still also slightly higher length compared to the depth of body, 5 to 9. So that is a big, that is a difference. It's a difference, obviously, the sizes. We have 3 sizes in the UK and America. We have 4 here. We have all colors, all solid colors accepted in England and the States, not FCI. We have 5. And it's a little bit difference in the head too. It's 50-50 skull to muzzle in at least the American standard, and slightly shorter in the FCI. So there are differences.
If you would need to change the FCI standard, what would you change?
I would
change... If you would have the possibility, let's
yes,
say.
Yes, I would actually... The first thing I would change, so we had all solid colors accepted. And I would also take away all disqualifying faults except multicolored dogs. Mm-hmm. One thing that should absolutely be changed is the size limitation in standard poodles. It's a disqualifying fault in FCI to be over 62. And I would say there are very few best in show winning males that would be under 62. So this is actually a big thing. And I think when the judges, they don't handle that at all. You know, they wouldn't measure, and they accept them. Well, if you accept disqualifying faults with something like size, Why would anything else matter? I think it should be actually be done quite big different changes in the FCI standard. Sorry to say.
Yeah. Okay. Well, it's always interesting to say this thing. We talked a little bit about it, but let's say because here is going to be more or less my end of my talking to you about poodles. When you look at the poodle, what is the thing that you think that defines the correct type of the breed? What you find the most important part of one poodle?
They have to have head carriage. They have to carry themselves. Head up, tail up, short back.
Okay.
Lightness.
Yeah, and tell me, because not only you are a breeder, but as you said, you are a judge now, and you are judging poodles, obviously, all around the world. What would you say that at the moment is the biggest problem in the breed?
I think I would say not enough elegance, and that goes for all sizes. And it is a little bit different meaning in the different varieties. I think standard poodles, they are a lot of times a little bit on the heavier side. They should have more angulation in front and the rear to get a more sort of softer outline, not this hard outline. The underline on the, especially many standard poodles, is lacking the underline. They go straight from the elbows back with a deep skirt, a deep, not enough tuck up. And it should actually be a quite elegant line there. So that's a little bit with the standard poodles. And it has always been difficult to get really good heads on the standard poodle. And for any judges that want to learn more about heads, start to think about the nose bridge. It should be straight line. It should not be like an Afghan. It should not go be a Roman nose. It should be straight. That's one thing. With medium poodles, I think it has always been a little bit too heavy dogs. You know, it's overall too heavy body type that is also put up. I judged one top winning bitch that went her rib cage went at least 2 or almost 3 centimeters below the elbow, that's unacceptable. Should not be in a top winner. And I think toys and dwarfs, they a lot of times they lack general construction. They should have more sort of be more a dog that could be sort of sounder.
Yeah, most of them are completely empty in porches and no chest, and many of them, what you mentioned also before, and I think that's one of the big problems in the breed, is that you have a lot of these dogs which just don't have any muscles. They are just like skin and bones and no muscles, nothing. I think that's a problem, one of the problems.
And I think that goes for many breeds. When I'm judging other breeds too, I'm becoming more and more fanatic about that, you know, very soft dogs.
Yeah, yeah. Anyhow, this was, let's say, my part with you about the poodles, and I think we have covered more or less all the interesting questions. There is a question from Anna Sabo, which I'm going to ask you later, because after the short questions, we are going to talk a little bit about judging. But she's asking you, I would love to hear Mika's definition of a really good dog judge. So I suppose we will talk a little bit later about this. Monica Halmi saying, thank you, Ante and Mikael. Wonderful to listen to this talk about the breed. I'm in Lom for over 30 years. Agnese Diraco saying, thank you, Mikael and Ante. Katarina Strom, thanks for a very interesting interview. It was a pleasure. Jason Hoke, couldn't agree more about size. Monica Halmi is asking you, wait. It's all me and my computer. That's always a fight. She's asking, you would love to hear about the tail issue. What makes it absolutely unacceptable?
I must say, from being a judge, I think you have to sort of change the question a little bit, because it must be what that breed has to have to become the good breed. You have to look for the right type. You have to look for the good part, the good things about the dog. Any dog have faults or mistakes, something, areas of improvement. And I would rather accept a little bit if I get the right, beautiful dog. So it really depends on which dog it is too. But tail, it's quite clear how the ideal tail should be. It should be sort of straight up or a little bit an angle towards back, behind the dog.
Yeah, but that has changed quite a lot now when they cannot be docked anymore, I suppose.
Yes, so we are accepting a little bit going over the back, but going around, I think if it looks like a round pom-pom, I think it's kind of acceptable. When it goes down to on the back, it's not the way it should look, and definitely not down to the loin area, you know. And sometimes you see that. I wouldn't keep anything like that for myself. It when I'm breeding, it has to have air in front and under the tail. You know, it cannot go.
Yeah, it spoils the general picture in general. Yeah, and then obviously, I suppose one of the last questions about poodles tonight, Sue Impe is asking you, what do you think of the head being held back like a pom with heads over withers? Do you think they lack porches?
They could do. But I would absolutely say I rather take that type of head carriage than leaning forward or nothing. So head up is for me very important, no matter how they do it. Of course, they shouldn't lean back too much like a pom. But
a kind of balance between these two things.
There is. Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Quick questions, which most of the people find quite difficult. I suppose you will find them difficult too, but I'm sure you will survive. One show you judge, then you will never forget.
Well, sometimes I hear your guests go a little bit off the question. I will also answer 2 here.
Okay.
Because obviously judging toy poodles at Poodle Club of America National Specialty, PCA, is a big thing. The first foreign judge for 50 years. And I'm also the youngest judge ever to judge that. And it was a wonderful experience. And
how many were entered?
Oh, I can't remember. I can't remember. Yeah, that it was a big entry, and also it's special because it's the members that are voting. So they voted me, and that's always a wonderful thing.
Yeah.
And then the second show, and which gave me the biggest pleasure and the biggest rush ever, was judging Standard Poodles at the World Show in Amsterdam. And well, I think those bitches in the end, you know, you can't get that. You can't get a better feeling than that. It was.
Yeah, I have been there. I have seen it, and the atmosphere around the ring was just amazing.
It was, and and in the end, I was so happy with my winner, and I think she is so much the type I'm looking for, and it's really a breeder's choice. I know that so many other people around the world thought any of the white bitches were their favorite, but for me, it doesn't matter how much they clap for the other ones. I will sleep with my own choice, and I'm so happy of course. With this black bitch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Another difficult question. Best poodle you ever judged?
Best poodle I ever judged.
I'm not planning to make it easy for you. I always put inside some other questions, you know, just to make your life complicated.
There have been quite a few beautiful ones. The dog I gave best of breed at PCA, best of varieties, was a beautiful dog, a white dog from Japan, and such a standout. And on the day, nothing could come close to beat him, and the way he held himself and carried himself, and went in like a superstar.
Mm-hmm.
I would say him now.
Yeah. Okay. Favorite poodle of all times, not bred, shown or owned by you. So it can be a dog that you have never judged, but
yes,
maybe can be a dog that is not alive anymore or whatever.
Yes, and it has to be the circumstance and the show and the drama it's created and all that. And that time when Gordon went into PCA and just took the ring by storm, it was fantastic. It was like you couldn't look at any other dog. And I mean, Gordon, it was Manetas del Sarsoso Fuego Fato, the dog Tina and Juha Palosari, Tina Taulos now had in Finland, and he was number one all breeds there. And it was Carlos Renault and Juan Cabrera who owned him. And he was later on exported to the States and had this fantastic career there. But that time when he entered the ring was fantastic. I will never forget it.
Yeah, there are some dogs that you just see them and you never forget this picture. The best dog that you ever bred?
It's hard when you have some heart dogs that is really more close to your heart. But I would say we talk a lot about show dogs here, and I would say Kudos the Knockout was the ultimate show dog. And no matter if it was pouring down rain, he gave it all. And he was a fabulous poodle. I thought he had so much of what you need to be a superstar.
Lila will be happy with this answer. The favorite win with your own dogs?
Yes. Now I'm going to change your question again.
I'm going to say
the biggest, the best day in my life and as an exhibitor, because it was not one day on that, one win on that day. It was a world show in Stockholm 2008. And I won with the Kudos Kurnikova, best junior in show. And then I won the group under Paul Stanton with Kudos Stolichnaya. And on the same day, also best breeders group in show under no other than Claire Coxell. And I think that was, those maybe 2 hours were probably very hard to beat in my life.
And, okay.
Winning with a breeders group under Claire Cox was fantastic.
Yeah, I can imagine. One breed you never had at home, but you would love to.
Oh, I know it would never probably happen, but I'm tempted to have a wire fox terrier. I think that it's a wonderful dog.
Yeah, they are very stylish. One dog person which is not alive anymore and you terribly miss.
Well, it's not going to be very different from any other of your guests. I think Carlos Renault is someone I terribly miss. And I think he gave so much. Whenever you met him, you had a great conversation. And he was full of life. And he was full of knowledge. And he was very generous. And I was happy to spend a lot of time with him. Also in his home in Madrid, and it was, I miss him. And I think we need him. We need people like him.
Absolutely agree. He was one of these people that once you meet them, you never forget them. For your opinion, one breeder that manages year after year to produce top quality dogs, doesn't matter in which breed, one breeder from Sweden and one from the rest of the world.
Yes, it's interesting questions. It's difficult because you don't know exactly what people show, and you base it on what you see on Facebook and all that. I am very impressed by what the Merrimack breeders of Irish Terriers, year after year, generation after generation. And I would say, you know, I'm not a breed expert by no means, but they look very similar, and they have and whenever you go to other countries, they don't really look like that. And if that's a good thing or a bad thing, but they really have a kind of look. And I think it's very impressive. And I would say worldwide, I think it's very impressive work was what the Smash Kennel is doing in Japan with the toy poodles. And I've been lucky to have been there for many times, probably 15 times, and it's very interesting to see how the kennel is producing and how it's developing. And some people are critical to what they see, because we see only a few dogs brought to America and a few dogs brought to Europe once in a while, but I've seen many dogs in the kennel, and there are other dogs too that never have make the headlines, but are good poodles.
Yeah. Okay. One judge who is still active judging, who always impress you with his ring presence and knowledge. One from Sweden and one from the rest of the world.
I think that. It's very hard in Sweden. I think we have mainly two judges that are world famous, that are standouts, and it's Dan Eriksson and Annika Ultvedtmo. And I think they are really clever and they're knowledgeable, and it's always interesting to listen to them and to talk dogs with them.
Mm-hmm. From the rest of the world?
From the rest of the world, I was preparing a little bit what I was going to answer, because I was thinking what you were going to ask me. I think that there are some breed specialists in poodles that are excellent judges. I'm also going to say a few. Dennis McCoy in America and Lee Cox in the UK.
Okay, wonderful. Tell me, Mike, you are lucky because there are only two more difficult questions. Best dog you ever judged, but not a poodle. Well, not the best dog. One dog that has impressed you incredibly a lot when you have judged him, and it was not a poodle.
I had some wonderful experiences last year judging Whippets. And I love judging whippets, and I think it's so wonderful experience, you know, from a beauty perspective, and you have to use all your senses when you're judging them. And I judged a beautiful bitch in Denmark from Portugal. I also judged another bitch from the same bloodline, a Swedish bitch. Two whippet bitches, beautiful.
Yeah. Okay. Last difficult question. 5 persons, not important if they are alive or dead, who made the greatest impact on you in the dog world?
Oh, obviously Astrid. Must be Astrid. She's a great person, and she changed my life in so many ways. She's still there. We talk once in a while, and we have a great time. So it must be Astrid. And together with Carlos, obviously, they were a great couple. I think I'm adding Lee Cox and Roger Stone into that plot.
Okay, one more.
Toshi.
Okay, wonderful. Okay, you have survived the difficult questions. okay, we have been going already 1 hour and 45 minutes, and comments and people are staying there and watching. So obviously, it's quite an interesting interview for everyone. Tell me a little bit about your connection with the Poms, because you won the group at Crafts in 2012 with the Pom. That has been another major win for you, but not with poodles.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh, it was my partner, Fredrik Nilsson, who I had at the time, and he was a Pom breeder. And we went to show two dogs. The bitch was second in open, and the dog was from junior class. I think it was maybe 15 months old, very young dog. And he managed to win the breed and then the group.
Yeah.
So that was wonderful.
Do you like Poms?
Yes, I do. And I got very much involved in them. But it's a nightmare breeding them. There's so many heartaches and it's so difficult on so many levels. And if you happen to breed a beautiful one, well, then the judges don't even understand it. So I think it's very, very difficult situation. And worldwide, it is a breeding that has been... it has a lot of trouble with the coat and the skin problems, and I think it's unfortunately created by the judges. I can't say anything else. They must understand more before they point. And this is a breed where you really need breed experts, and hardly at any of the major shows we get the breed experts. So it's very wrong dogs put up a lot of times. Sorry.
Yeah, it's a breed that became very popular, and the numbers are big, and I think they are not easy to judge, especially for somebody who is not involved in the breed. I don't think it's I think it has a kind of a similar problem as the poodles. You know, when you see a nicely groomed dog, and then if you don't have the eye for what is under the coat, it's difficult to put up a dog which is maybe not perfectly groomed, but still looks
I think better under the... I think the Poms also changed drastically from, let's say, the 60s, 70s or so, until what they look like now. And it's very strange. A lot of, I hear a lot of people praising the old English Hadley lines and Hadley dogs. And they were gorgeous dogs, gorgeous Poms with the breed characteristics. But the dogs that win now, they have very little resemblance to that. And, it's very strange. And it's strange that so many people have them, have those Hadley dogs as ideal, when what they point at in the ring is looking completely different.
Yeah.
I would say that the dog we won at Crofts with, and also the second dog that we had that was best of breed at the World Show in Finland, they are more the old-fashioned look, and you know, they are very slowly maturing, so they don't look like a best in show winner when they are 11 months old, really. They need to look a little bit raw.
And what is your connection with the Afghans?
Oh, one of our best friends is breeding Afghans, and so I've had I've been co-owners on quite a few of those dogs, so I actually have shown them. And we had, especially one dog was top sight hound in Denmark, and I enjoy them a lot. I think it's a very interesting breed, and but very hard, very hard. And the last dog I was co-owner on, a very beautiful dog that, but he was, and he liked me, and he came up to me and he was wagging the tail, but he refused to move with me, no matter what I did. So,
they are special. Sight hounds in general, they are special. Anyhow, let's talk a little bit about judging. What I want to ask you, we as exhibitors, we are quite often critical to the judges. You know, when we sit ringside and we say, "Oh, I would not do it this way," or "I would do it that way. He missed the best dog," and so on and so on. When you became a judge in 2004, did you, when you started to judge, do you think it is easier than what you thought, or it's harder than what you thought it is?
I think it's quite hard to judge. I don't take it lightly, and I think it's difficult. A lot of people think it's difficult because you will get a friend or an enemy in the ring or a top winner or something. I don't think that is the hard part at all. But it's hard to analyze a dog correctly, and especially of breeds you're not that familiar with, that you haven't owned. You don't exactly know how they develop from a young age up to older. It's not easy, and I study a lot, to say it like that.
Tell me, let's go back. I don't know, to on my computer it says, "Sorry, we're having trouble with playing this video. I hope it's not for other people too. I hope it's only for me." Wait 1 second, just let me check if we are still there or not. Mrs. Rupan was doing her entries, so she missed.
Mic on.
Sleeping. Okay, Beltran says everything is perfect and you can see it. It's just my computer. Then it's fine. Let's continue. Just I wanted to find this
mic off.
Let me find it from Anna, which was something about judging. But let me see. I don't know if you remember what she was asking.
Didn't she ask about the characteristics of a great judge or something like that?
Yeah, something like this. Yes, let's. People are now writing. Everything is okay. So it's just my computer. This is what I'm saying. I need to find a good sponsor because I definitely need the new computer. Why cannot find this? Now I will find it, I'm sure. She was asking, I think, what do you think that it makes a great judge?
I think first and foremost it is the ethical part. You know, you have to judge from a fair perspective, and you must be doing your own thing. I think there are too many judges just copying what other people are doing, I really don't understand why some people seem to take some political approach to their judging. I don't think, I don't understand what they gain. You know, I don't understand why they put up the dogs that they sometimes don't even think are the best ones. You know, I really don't understand it. It's, I do understand that it could be lack of knowledge. You know, if you don't know exactly, it's easier to copy what someone else did. I can understand that. But then I don't understand why you don't search for the knowledge. Yeah. If you find yourself you don't know what exactly is it a good one, is it not, I have never seen this thing, particular thing on the dog, on the breed, why don't ask a breed specialist, talk to the breeders. Yes. You know, I think it's a lack of knowledge, you know. If they knew, they wouldn't be able to do sometimes what they're doing.
Yeah. Well, that's always, and I mean, not everybody can be a specialist in every breed, but as long as people have a will to learn, I'm sure that it can happen. But there must be a will to learn. That's for sure. Tell me, talking about difficulties of judging. You said you were the youngest person ever to judge at the PCA, and I mean, it is your breed, it is the breed in which you have been for all your life, but how difficult was it for you? For sure it was a big enjoyment, I'm sure about it, but was it also difficult in a way?
I would say it wasn't. It was one of these shows where the dogs just sort of sorted themselves out. It was a huge entry, but it was kind of, in my opinion, quite easy to judge. And, I will tell you one story about it, because the handler of the winner's dog and best of winners, he came up to me after and he thanked me for the win. And he said, I knew you were going to put him up. Oh, how could you? Yeah, because I was at the World Show in Stockholm and I saw all your dogs there and your breeders group and everything. And I just thought, oh, if he's judging like he's breeding, he will put this dog up, which I did. And the same thing on the day, one of the Danish breeders saw the dog on the day and he said he wanted to buy it and it wasn't for sale, but he managed to buy it. And he said, I thought it was quite cheap because he knew in the end of the day it would have been would be best of winners or mm-hmm. best winner's dog. So I think it's important, and I'm quite proud of that, people are able to follow what you're doing, and I think that's quite important. And I think it could have been for many American breeders and poodle people, they kind of liked a few other dogs in that lineup, but I think with my eyes from breeding dogs in the FCI countries and from what where I'm from, coming my from background, yeah. It had to be that dog.
Yeah. Tell me, what is the favorite part of judging for you?
You know, there are many things, and I obviously enjoy judging and doing all that. I always loved traveling, and I always loved seeing new things and new cultures and meet new people. And I think, I think it's, dogs are important, but I think people are important in my life, and without people there are no dogs. So yeah, I really enjoy to meet a lot of people, and now I must say I'm becoming a little bit older. I don't have really that urge to go into the ring anymore fighting. I think it costs a lot to me to go into the ring nowadays. You know, there have been some losses that it's hard to go to come over.
So you are like me, a bad loser.
In some ways,
it comes
not
with the
normally, but it depends on how you're losing.
I can understand. I'm a bad loser, and I always say it. And what can I do? It's one of the things probably that's connected with the date of the birth. Yes. Anyhow, I have one question here for you. And it's my last question before the last two. But then there is one question also in the comment here, which is a little bit nasty in my way. So I can read it for you, or I don't need to read it, because normally I would not read it. But if you insist, I can read it. But I will ask my question. How difficult is to judge dogs shown by friends or by people you admire? And it's a little bit it's a little bit connected with the comment of one lady, but mine is in a positive way and hers is in a bad way. So okay. Let's keep mine.
Well, I don't find it is that difficult. You know, I always, from having been doing this hard work for so many years, sleepless nights breeding these dogs and building a bloodline, and have been driving all nights and grooming dogs forever, you know, the best dog must win. The judge must try his best to do it. And, you know, I don't care if it's you in my ring or if it's someone else. I would do whatever I feel to do. That's the job I'm there to do. And And I see no other way. And I really don't think it is that difficult.
Yeah. Okay. We are coming to the last two questions. Then we are going to finish this. We have done 2 hours talking and a lot of wonderful comments and a lot of people still watching. So I suppose they have found it as interesting as I did. I don't know how you say it when it's not the last one, but before the last question would be, what would you say to the young people who are thinking of dedicating their life to the sport of dogs?
Welcome. Welcome.
Yeah, that's the best answer anybody has said till now. And, but do you think it's a cruel world in a way?
It can be, and I think it can be on a top level. I have been quite lucky to, I am quite strong and I don't really, it doesn't go into me too much, but it can be tough. It can be. It seems like a world that is attracting a little bit of this win at all costs, and if you can't win in any other way, you find a way anyway. There are many things like that. But I think it has been a wonderful place in my life. And I've so much to thank the dogs for and to thank my mentors for. And I think that would actually be the suggestion for anybody to find a good mentor and be nice all the way. You know, you don't stab your friends in the back. There are so much bad things you hear about and so many broken deals and broken friendships. That's not the way, you know, it's not, you don't fight over dogs. I never fight over dogs. If someone wants to be bad, it's not my problem.
Yeah, that's a good attitude. Okay. My last question for you, and you have partly answered it before. When you look at the future of the sport, do you feel optimistic or pessimistic? And how do you think this whole world will look in, let's say, 10 years?
Yes, I am a very positive person and very optimistic, really. That's my nature. And I think that is why I have been able to have a nice career in this world. But I think there has to be something happening, and soon. I think we have to organize us. I don't understand why we haven't done it before. You know, all this with the brachycephalic breeds. We need to gather around this, unite ourselves. I think we need to put the kennel clubs together. FCI together. We need to have a lot of money put into PR campaigns. We need lobbyists. We need really to promote what we're doing. And if we don't do it now, it is not going to happen. So I think if we are going to have this sport, we have to be more professional than ever. And I'm not even sure we should wait for the kennel clubs to do it. I'm not sure we can wait for the FCI to do anything about it. I think we have to organize now and gather money, putting the right people in front and facing the reality. And we cannot wait because we have lost a couple of battles already, and we don't want to lose the war. And well, yeah.
These are challenging times, that's for sure.
It is.
Anyhow, before we finish this, I will read you few last comments. Hilde Berit Berghausen saying, very interesting interview. Tracy Hindley saying, this has been very interesting. Thank you both for your time and an insight into your experience. Deborah Serra saying, congrats to everybody. Thanks. Carmen Sifonte saying, it's been a treat. Thanks so much from the other side of the pond. Francesco Cocchetti saying, excellent. Find a good mentor and listen to him, her. So there has been a lot of incredible comments coming more. Thanks for a great evening. Very interesting and many wise words. Never forget Kudos Absolute. Enter the ring in Denmark. Talk about goosebumps, says Marlene Sofberg. Brina Tomer saying, great interview, candid and educative. Thank you. So I'm very happy, of course, whenever we finish the interview, that there has been a lot of people watching it and that there has been a lot of excellent comments. I was sure that when I invited you as a guest that you will be interesting because you are also very interesting in your personal life. And I think it's amazing to talk dogs with you. I thank you for your time. I hope you have survived this almost 2 hours of talking with me. I hope you have also enjoyed it. And before I say goodnight for all the people who have been with us, let's get the last message from you.
Well, of course, I would like to thank you, Ante, for inviting me, and I hope you thought it was interesting. And it was nice to see that many people would like to listen to me and what I had to say about poodles and dogs in general. Well, I hope, like everybody else, that times are changing and we will be able to meet all of us again. And I hope that we all will take the next level of the dog world in a little bit more positive way than sometimes before. And well, thank you all.
Yeah. Okay. Let's finish then this interview with a few last comments, just that you get an idea, because you can also see it later. But that you get an idea how many people have appreciated listening to you. Egle Dildaite saying, very lovely interview. Nina Danielson saying, thanks, Mike. Hope to see you in Åland soon. Oh, Åland, I remember that place. Elisa Ahoka saying, thank you. Always pleasure to listen to you. Lena Lundgren saying, thanks. Pia Blomberg saying, bravo. Yuli, I always have problems pronouncing your surname. Again, a super interesting, amazing interview. Wednesday evenings will never be boring again. Thank you. Bitte Fagerlund saying thank you. Alex Rojas saying tak tak krams. Kari Granas Hansen saying thank you, very interesting. Francesco Cocchetti, well done guys. Fairly Cotton de Tuer, super interview. Venture Charlotte Skogli saying very nice evening, stay safe and sound. Veronica Toren, great night, thanks. Christina Kiki Johnson, thank you. Bruno Paola Viviana Nodali, thanks so much, Mike and Ante, well done. Agneta Angstrom, thanks. Sabine Vaderzvan, wonderful, interesting interview. Thank you both. Christy J. Trim Van Ziel, thank you for a lovely evening. Eva Sjoberg, thank you. So a lot of people have been watching, Mike, and it has not been my private thing to say that I have enjoyed it. Really, a lot of people have enjoyed it. And I'm so happy to have actually this opportunity in my life to bring great dog people to the other people like you are. And once again, thank you so much for the great evening. And I, the same like you, I really wish hope. And I hope that soon the better times will come and we will be able to meet each other as we were doing it in the years before. Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Mike, once again, and hope to see you all soon. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
hoy la nostalgia perdió tu recuerdo, las ansias por la carretera soñando al ritmo del corazón. Aposté mi sueldo a una falda que escalé con cuerdas de guitarra. Quise guardar las memorias que encierran cada canción. No podré lamentar si eres parte de mí.